Good morning, ladies and gentlemen.
I'm Tim Potts, the director of the Getty Museum. It's a great pleasure to welcome you here today to this symposium to celebrate the 175th anniversary of the invention of photography. And as the screen indicates, there we are, the theme of this celebration of that history is focusing on the view from here, namely LA and its role and contribution to the development of photography in the recent past. And of course, Los Angeles has a very rich role to play, and has played a very important part. Very major photographers, Carlton Watkins, Edward Weston, Ed Ruscha, Herb Ritz, and many of the panelists today, prominent and active photographers working in and associated with Los Angeles, have played a major role, not only for photography in this city and this part of the world, but indeed nationally and internationally. So we're very grateful to all of them for being here. And of course, the department here, the Department of Photography, new as it is, and remember, it only was created in 1984, but in that 30 years has become one of the great collections of photography anywhere in the world. And it has played an important part in raising the awareness, the consciousness, and education about photography generally. It was just old enough to have been in a position to celebrate the 150th anniversary of the invention of photography in 1989, and it did so with a symposium entitled Photography, Discovery, and Invention. This year, as I've said, we're looking at the role of Los Angeles and the very prominent role in promoting the medium through three particular themes. The tradition of photographic education across Southern California, and these, of course, each of the panels will address one of these. The tradition of photographic education across Southern California, the ways in which Los Angeles inspires the work of photographers as a subject and as a place to create their work, and the roles of institutions, exhibitions, and criticism in shaping our appreciation of the medium. We have three very distinguished groups of panelists and moderators, and I thank all of them for being here, and they will lead us through those three issues or themes. I also want particularly to thank the Photographs Council of the Getty Museum for all that it does in supporting the acquisition program of the museum, of the department, but also on occasion sponsoring, as they have, and making possible events like this, and in particular the subcommittee of the council that worked so hard to make this possible. They really have. This is their achievement, and it's wonderful to see the reception to it as strong as it is today with all of you here. Now, I'm going to hand over now. This is one other thing I want to say is that this was very much conceived as a series of panels and discussions, not a day of straightforward lectures where you sit here and listen to one person saying what they have to say. It is a dialogue, it is a discussion, but we do have one keynote speaker who's going to set us on that path. And we're delighted to have George Baker, the Associate Professor of Art History here at UCLA. He's a graduate of Yale, of the Independent Study Program of the Whitney Museum, and for his doctorate at Columbia. In the 90s, he was based in New York and Paris, where he wrote for Art Forum magazine and as an editor of the journal October and their publication, Imprint October Books. Since 2003, he's been here at UCLA teaching modern and contemporary art and theory. He's done his courses have focused on aspects of modernism and the historical avant-garde, and the history of particularly of photography in the 19th and 20th centuries, and specialized topics in post-war and contemporary art history. Currently, he's working on a revisionist study of Picasso's modernism and a book on the work of four women artists, Zoe Leonard, Tacita Dean, Moira Davey, and Sharon Lockhart, which will be entitled Lateness and Longing on the Afterlife of Photography. So that's something to look forward to. So without further ado, let me invite Professor Baker to come up and give us his keynote talk on looking back at photography. Professor Baker.
Thank you very much for the introduction, and thank you very much for the opportunity to speak at an event, obviously, that is creating a lot of excitement, judging by how many people have come here today. I just want to thank myself, the Photography Council, for the invitation. I want to thank as well the members of the curatorial team and the photography department here at the Getty, Virginia Heckert and Judith Keller, Amanda Maddox, and others who've helped me get to the point of having a PowerPoint to present to you today. And I also want to give a special thank you to Rick Ehrlich, who's in the audience, who I think has something to do with my getting invited here today. I need maybe a minute's help to have a PowerPoint from the curatorial team. I need more help. All right, so I have a talk of a good solid 40 minutes. I'm going to try to time myself and be good. But not too long, I hope. And my remarks will have very little to do with photography in Los Angeles, but they will have to do with photography. And that's the brief that I've taken on today. In this lecture, I'm calling Looking Back on Photography. My lecture today, some of you will recognize, borrows its title from a well-known essay by the German philosopher and critic Theodor Adorno, his account of the surrealists written a long time ago that he simply called Looking Back on Surrealism. Adorno has become an important figure for my recent work on the fate of photography today, especially his ideas on lateness and late style, and the potential such ideas about anachronism and untimeliness now hold, given the directions that photography takes today. In this spirit, I want to begin with an epigraph. It comes from the era of the high modernism of the photograph. It comes from Laszlo Moholy-Nagy, from his classic text, Painting, Photography, Film, as cited actually in another classic text, the critic Walter Benjamin's essay, The Little History of Photography. And so I quote, "The creative possibilities of the new are mostly discovered slowly through old forms, old instruments, old structures, which are fundamentally injured by the appearance of new things, but which, under the pressure of the new emerging things, are driven up into a last euphoric flourishing." Now, Moholy-Nagy was discussing painting, actually, when he mentions old forms in this quote I've just cited, with photography then positioned as his new. My title and this epigraph are thus evidently not meant to put us on this occasion of birthdays and anniversaries. I feel like someone should sing this birthday song for photography. Not me, though. In the spirit of celebrating photography's ending, such a thought would be ludicrous. Paradoxically, and in the wake of its digitalization, photography has never been more generalized as a practice of everyday life, never more extensively a part of how we live and experience the world. I'm thinking of the image swarms of things like Tumblr, Instagram, the cameras in every activity and space of contemporary life. I snapped a few photos of all of you before I got up here just a minute ago. The endless, roiling image streams, the 250 billion photographs, according to a statistic cited by the artist Trevor Paglen, I guess that's a year-old statistic, though, so far posted to the site Facebook. Instead, I think we can reverse Moholy's terms today and begin to think quite simply about photography as what the modernists once called an old form. My title, Looking Back on Photography, does imply a certain sense of culmination, of development, of lateness even, the need for a retrospective glance. But it also hopes to pose a very simple question. When did photography become a backward-looking medium? And what does it mean to think of photography in this way, as oriented increasingly toward the past, and perhaps towards its past? I'm showing you a Christmas gift that I received from the artist Wally Beshi, just to explain what's on the screen before you. And the anonymous photograph on the other side of the screen is not by Wally Beshi. I guess it's by my mom, because that's me and my brother. But I like them together. One strain of photographic thinking always associated the medium with memory, of course, with the retention and preservation of that which is gone, with the embalming of the archive and the frozen rigidity of the visual fossil. But we remember, of course, with Moholy, when photography was associated with the new, capital N. It was a form of machinic vision, an all-encompassing new vision, to use the modernist term, a prosthetic sight, a technological and broadly utopian force that would recode and transform the traditional forms of art and human sensation. And we can skip forward, of course, from modernism's futurist fantasies. Even more recently, the photograph was still seen as perhaps the central transformative engine of the critical aspirations of postmodern aesthetics, as that force of quotation, copying, and remediation that would again, and paradoxically, in the face of its repetitions, be hailed as a force of the new, transcoding and completely altering the cultural situation of art. Now, I want to claim that our situation today is different. What happens when photography is no longer a technological force of the new? More importantly, what occurs when its primary imagination and fantasy seems to change direction, to look back and push toward the past in some admittedly new and fundamental way? A few years ago, I was asked to take part in a conference not unlike this one, I think, organized by SF MoMA around the simple question, and this was the name of the conference, is photography over? The question I responded back then was, of course, hyperbolic, overblown, I think meant to gather an audience as big as the one that's come here today, and it worked. But I was interested in relation to this question, is photography over, in what the great critic Frank Kermode in his book called, of this title, the sense of an ending, that we feel this today around photography. I'm interested, like Kermode, in the directions and possibilities that such narratives of photography's end perhaps make possible. I am specifically interested, actually, in the connections that our current endgame stories about photography make to other such narratives and other moments in photography's history. I think, looking back, for example, of Walter Benjamin predicting the rebirth of photography in the wake of the stock market crash of 1929, of his hopes for a return to the forgotten potentials of the medium before its industrialization in the 19th century. This, of course, is his canonical text, The Little History of 1931. I think, too, of the photographer Walker Evans announcing what he called the reappearance of photography around the same historical events, and that's his essay, The Reappearance of Photography, also of 1931. I think of the critic Roland Barthes in his book essay Camera Lucida, prioritizing similarly atavistic potential of the medium at a moment of later economic recession, that of the 1970s when he composed his book, which is also the moment immediately preceding the technological shift from the analog to the digital that we have subsequently witnessed. We exist today in a moment not unlike these, the Great Recession, right? As opposed to the Great Depression or the oil crisis. All of them moments of historical and economic crisis, perhaps even epical transition, moments that once, in fact, seemed to provoke major rethinkings and reorientations of photography in both theory and practice. The Benjamin, Evans, and Bart essays on photography, with their stories they all seem to tell of a fundamental possibility of the return of photography to its origins, seem to amount to fantasies of what we might call, and what I've been calling, photographic atavism. They are primitivist, as opposed to technological or utopian fantasies of the photograph. The return, the repetition, turning back is the fundamental operation of the photograph. Such is the very structure of what I've been coming to call photographic atavism. Atavism, this term from the Latin atavus, grandfather of my grandfather, signaling today a genetic, well-nigh biological eruption of a long-past trait. Atavism, of course, connotes reversion, even retroversion. It's the historical throwback, the return of the lost object, the reappearance of that which has been thought definitively to have disappeared. Genes hide atavisms when they're not expressed, a biological mode of preservation, a kind of hidden secret. Photography's preservationist powers seem hardly a step away, perhaps also its modes of obfuscation and opacity. But biological atavisms are often considered monstrous, impossible hybrids, the hind leg on the back of a whale, the tail on a human fetus, webbed hands and feet in a land-loving mammal. So I'm kind of interested in photography in these terms. Atavism thus appears like a mutation. It's not exactly that. It speaks instead, however, of the inherent power of the past to produce transformation from its very inertia, the shocking return that seems also to signal a kind of departure or new form. And so I've become interested, actually, in photographic forms that stage something like the sense of a medium's ending, a dispersal that's also, strangely, paradoxically, impossibly, a form of return to lost or forgotten potentials of photography. Now I want to offer up, I've been showing you some work in progress by Walid Beshti with a somewhat provocative title that I'm not going to comment much on. I want to show you one example of what I'm thinking of many potential ones. The New York-based artist Moira Davies' early photographic series from the 1990s that she entitled Copperheads. Andreas Gursky's photo tableau 99 Cent from the end of that decade of the 90s, one iteration of this became, for a short while at least, the most expensive photograph ever sold, right? It could be imagined as the series' antitype. Produced again during a moment of prior economic recession, Davies' low-tech color images focus on the profile of Abraham Lincoln engraved on the US penny, the cheapest or most devalued piece at this moment of American currency. Copperheads thus comprise an archive of silhouettes, a typology of portraits, the silhouettes seeming to point back to one of the origins of the photographic impulse itself, an early form of the medium. And yet the kind of recursivity that Davies seeks is not exactly self-reflexive or medium-specific at all. She seems to try to locate photographic qualities in an analog completely outside the medium of the photograph itself. Basically worthless, the pennies that Davy depicts are, quote, like photographs in many different ways. They're objects of circulation, objects of use. They're objects cut close to the body in wallets and pockets and fingered by hands. They're tokens stamped with their time and date. They're small objects, miniatures, enlarged by the photograph's innate habit of holding on tight to its object world, progeny of the close-up and the zoom. They're obsolete, throwaway vestiges, but also keepsakes, collector's items, useless avatars of what seems to be blind luck or cunning thrift simultaneously. Indeed, each copperhead seems memorial to photography's eradication in the series, or perhaps its ceaseless dedication to that which is itself on the verge of disappearance. The works capture the immeasurable variety of the decay of each cast profile upon the penny surface, embodying meditations upon loss, erosion, and the slipping of a thing into the status of detritus. And yet, in focusing on this image loss, the copperheads depict the penny as a receptor surface, a skin infinitely susceptible to wounds, gouges, scratches, in other words, a site of contact, an object like the photograph, endlessly opening to receiving the marks of the world. They also depict the penny as a reactive surface, the site of myriad eruptions and chemical blooms. In recording this, Davies' copperheads mirror photography in yet another way. They're, of course, images of serial objects, replicas, all given over to the condition of absolute chance and absolute singularity. And thus, if each photograph seems an image of disappearance, a cast or imprint seeming to fade away before our eyes, the image's condition as what we might call last photographs can also then be reversed. For it's as if we gaze upon photograph after photograph of what seem to be latent images, a form at the point of its emergence, like a landmass surfacing from the ocean's depths, an unknown object blanketed by deep but melting snow. The photographs are images of destruction and resurrection, loss and potential rebirth at the same time. Arranged in a recent artist book, devoted to the series, with one photograph following the other, as I've been kind of showing them to you here, one image to a page. The typology was transformed in this book into a kind of flipbook, a proto-cinematic device carrying the photograph and the image into other domains. So I can't produce the flipbook for you, but I can play with the PowerPoint, and you get a sense of what this artist book did to the series. It did this. Which you can spend many hours doing. And here another iteration more recently of the photographs reprinted last year for an exhibition at Tate Liverpool, where they were then folded, stamped, addressed, and mailed to the exhibition, unfolded, and then pinned to the walls. We see, in a sense, in this series, I want to claim, another mode of what Walker Evans once called photography's reappearance, another form of the photograph's periodic and atavistic emergence. So, in the time left to me today, I want to look closely at the work of one more artist that I'm working on recently, but also, I think, involved in this rethinking of photography in the spirit of a case study. I began today showing you an image of the artist Zoe Leonard's recent experiments producing large-scale camera obscuras, spatial interventions most recently mounted at the Chinati Foundation at Marfa in Texas and at the Whitney Museum during the 2014 biennial. So the occasion of my remarks today was really inspired by the news that, you can tell I wrote my remarks quite recently, that Zoe Leonard won the Buxbaum Prize for her contribution of this camera obscura piece to the Whitney Biennial. I'll have more to say about it as my remarks conclude. Simultaneous with this investigation in the camera obscura works that Leonard has been making of something like an form of the photographic apparatus, Leonard has been engaged in a daily practice, actually, of photographing the sun, the source of the photographic image of light writing itself, in a series of her signature black and white, grainy, and out of focus, or now seemingly impossible to focus prints. I want to account for this practice of Leonard's in the terms of the photographic atavism that I'm chasing today. In one of the earliest essays written about Zoe Leonard's work, the German artist painter Jutta Kotte described Leonard as grounding her activities in two deeply outmoded media right from the start of her career. Outmoded was the painter, the artist term. Photography and political activism. Kotte was referring to the fact that Leonard emerged as an artist both deeply engaged with photography and passionately committed to political activism, especially around the events of the AIDS crisis. It's hard to imagine how, in the waning days of a triumphant 1980s postmodernism, at least as I see it now, that the artist Kotte could have had the foresight then to call photography belated. And yet Leonard's early work can be linked to what now becomes visible as a series of deeply anachronistic, if not atavistic, photographic moves. First, we could point to Leonard's disjunctive choice during this decade to resurrect the small-scale gelatin silver print in the heyday of postmodern photography, with its glittering Hollywood allure and ever-increasing scale and eventual digital apotheosis. Against the media images and critical documentary forms of most postmodernism, Leonard returned to the central vehicle of modernist art photography, precisely the target of most postmodern critical assaults on photography's recent history. In addition, while many of Leonard's early images were focused on cities and urban representation, just as many returned to the realm of quote-unquote nature, to landscape, of course, and to still life, in the supposed postmodern moment of what was being hailed as a turn to culture, all the media images, advertising forms that were being investigated by other artists during this time. And finally, and perhaps most important, although seemingly least perceived, Leonard began to resurrect during these years of the 80s and early 90s. A thoroughly 19th century model, I want to claim, of primitive or early photography, the photography, one might say, of the amateur, often associated with women artists like Juliet Margaret Cameron or Lady Clementina Hawarden. Having left school at the age of 15 and essentially herself a self-taught photographer, Leonard's embrace of the tradition of the amateur makes a certain amount of sense. In this model, accident and contingency were embraced as inherent to the photographic process above all, and its physical, chemical, and indexical nature, its almost actually being a process of nature, prized above all things. These anachronisms, it seems to me, were only compounded in Leonard's recent project Analog, the work for which he's perhaps now best known, an archive of some 400 photographs in its final form, edited down from upwards of 15,000 that the artist took, upon which he then labored for a decade, from 1998 to 2007. Here, Leonard adopted the square format image characteristic of the old Rolleiflex camera, with which he now began to shoot, a device that seems particularly redolent of the post-war generation of New York School photographers. And with this old Rolleiflex, a leftover, this is the artist's words, a leftover from the mechanical age, Leonard began to document the shops and storefronts of her New York neighborhood, most of which were likely founded during these same post-war years. Like her outmoded analog images, many of the shops now teetered on the verge of extinction or already closed up and shuttered, victims of the city's recent and massive gentrification. And so Leonard's camera focused on the traces of this dying urban world, used appliance stores and rag trade suppliers, dry cleaners and television repair shops, old camera vendors and photo studios, AIDS beauty salons and mom and pop corner stores, windows filled with fried chicken or back to school shoes, faded signage, spreading graffiti, handwritten price tags with their numbers all different sizes. I'm quoting the artist, "There was a kind of beauty that I lived with for years that I never really noticed as beauty. I loved it. It was only as these old shops began disappearing that I realized how much this layered, frayed, and quirky beauty underlined my life. I felt at home in it. End of the quote. It bears remarking that the issue of home has been at the core of Leonard's endeavors as a photographer from the earliest moments of her work. Among her first photographs, we have many aerial images of cities or of models of her native New York, as well as rows upon rows of homes, urban and suburban, as well as traditional and even ancient. Some homes, we might even say, were natural, such as an example like this, the photograph Leonard made of a honeycomb at the center of a beehive. In Leonard's aerial images, always seemingly sprinkled with a thick film noir grain, the homes seem necessarily and impossibly distant, or at times outmoded and threatened, displaced in a way that made them the logical counterpoint to Leonard's simultaneously produced images of air travel, wistful photographs like lo-fi Alfred Stieglitz images, capturing momentary cloud formations from passenger windows and planes. And it also bears stating that Leonard would begin her analog project only after a long self-exile to the wilderness of Alaska, where she lived for several years in the early 1990s. I give you Beaver Guts from a larger series. I could have chosen other works, but for reasons both Alaskan and sexual, I'm going to choose this one for the moment to leave on the screen for you. Her recent project thus began actually with a return home to New York, which is a return home in a way, but only to realize seemingly that no return was possible. New York was yesterday, to use the artist Greg Bordowitz's phrase. It's good to say that from LA. Consequently, as Leonard turns to this obsolescent documentation of her threatened neighborhood, a home that's fading away, seeming never to return, we see few or no domestic spaces at all, but only register the labor of the artist, now herself displaced into the city streets in a very conscious echo of the tropes of documentary and street photography. And as opposed to the sedentary or static qualities that we may associate with home, Leonard's documents of her lost ones see the artist turned into an endless rag picker, a wanderer, perambulating urban space day after day. Eventually, this wandering or exile takes the artist away from New York altogether, as during the making of the series, she follows the displaced wares and commodities of the closed-down neighborhood stores, especially those involved in the rag trade, to such far-flung locales as Kampala in Uganda, or Amala in Jerusalem, Mexico City and Havana, Budapest and Warsaw. Now, if the longing to return home is actually the literal engine of what we call in our culture nostalgia, nostalgia's etymology comes from the combination of the two words signaling the ache to return home, this evident dynamic of photographic exile has a strong counterpart in Leonard's photographs. Is the sound okay? I haven't asked. Okay. For a long time, Leonard has been thinking of the photograph as a kind of receptacle, something like a waiting container crying out to be filled. I sense this in the first photographs by Leonard that I remember seeing in person, images that she made of birds' nests, and she exhibited in a show at the National Center for Photography in Paris back in 1998. Here, the nests themselves, seemingly another natural avatar of the home, were temporarily abandoned. And yet each was filled with waiting, but potentially orphaned eggs. The receptacle of the nest, filled with the container that is the egg, both of them filling the frame of the photograph, in a self-reflexive series of echoes that also seems a kind of gentle manifesto. The bird's nest as the fur form of photography. For receptacles actually seem to then run everywhere through Leonard's work, especially, we might say, in her photographically inflected non-photographs, the complicated way of saying her sculptures, like the imperfectly reconstituted and empty hollows of the memorial work she made and called Strange Fruit for David, memorializing the artist David Warnerovich, a work made from the sutured skins of consumed oranges, bananas, grapefruits, and lemons, or her found suitcase sculptures, which present accumulations of containers that, moreover, seemed to evoke the very displacement from home that otherwise exists alongside this model for the artist of thinking the photograph essentially as a kind of holder or receptacle form. And in fact, these receptacles run everywhere through analog. We might say that the shop windows at its heart are for the artist a kind of framing device, a frame within the frame, to which the photograph is attracted and can also be compared. But the shop windows don't only frame, they also contain. They are receptacles for the widest accumulation of objects upon which Leonard then trains her camera, a profusion of the used, abused, neglected, and man-made. Handmade, rather. Another image manifesto here. We're pushed up tight against the shop window, filled with discarded televisions, piled one atop the other and turned in all directions. It must be a repair shop at which we're gazing, but we're too close this time to glimpse the signage. In the glass, like a very self-conscious echo of Apje's photographs of cafes and shop windows from a century before, we can see the spectral reflection of the artist. She's bent over her Rolleiflex, looking down into its intimate depths, and of course we see when using this camera, it's pressed against the body as opposed to the head or the eye, held tight against the heart, the chest, the torso. It's as if Leonard wants to stress the affective as well as maternal, almost womb-like nature of this apparatus, the cavity, the receptive cavity that it can embody, as if too her taking of photographs was actually a form of amorous incorporation, an internalization of the image by the camera, not unlike a melancholic's incorporation of its lost objects. And the image that her camera receives is of the receptacle of the shop window, in this case holding its own boxes and receptacles, the televisions that may once have been technologies of radiant projection, but were also themselves analog receivers. In their broken down state, this is now in fact all the televisions seem to do. They accept reflections from the outside world. They receive the cars and the buildings and the street reflected in the shop window that also appear like ghosts flickering weakly upon the television's dead screens. This is in fact the first image in the selection from Leonard's archive as it's been published in its book form. As another manifesto then, or at least a place of origin, the starting point of the series, it announces that Leonard's photographs are receptacles, but it seems also I would want to claim to push further. It seems to proclaim that she as an author, like the televisions laid out before her, is also a receiver. Leonard always actually has stressed this about photography's potential. I'm quoting her again. "These are things that move me," Leonard stated, explaining the desiring nature of her photographic choices. "For me, photography is intrinsically about observation. It's about being present and having a certain perspective on the world. It's not so much about creating things. It's more about responding." It's a kind of common set of claims, but I just want to underline them. In this statement, though, Leonard approaches the model of what's been called a kind of authorial divestiture that the critic Kaja Silverman has recently named the model of the author as a receiver. In this thinking of attachment and care, in this connecting of photography to holding on and being close, so I'll show you some more images of receptacles in the analog project. In this imagining of photography as an open form, a form dedicated to incorporation and containing or receiving, I want to insist that we face Leonard imagining not just a mode of authorship, but a mode of subjectivity as much as of photography. The receptacle objects of strange fruit or Leonard's suitcase sculptures that I showed you a moment ago were already, in fact, considered by the artist surrogate subjects or portraits, models of subjectivity or being in effigy, invested with memory and desire. So the suitcase sculpture I showed you untitled a moment ago was actually deemed by the artist a portrait of her father. And all of those suitcase sculptures were considered to be analog beings that they were representing. And actually it's so for the receptacles in the photographs of analog as well. They model a kind of subject. In different ways, such an impulse goes back to the artist's earliest work. Some last images of receptacles in analog. In Leonard's earliest photographs, I'm showing you an image she made quite early on and printed more recently of her mother. In Leonard's earliest photographs, we face different forms of atavisms, as well as different reconnections to moments in the history of the photograph than analogs return to the Rolleiflex or to the New York School and its most notorious camera, or to street photography and documentary. So I want to end my presentation today by looking actually at the earliest work of this photographer that I've been exploring with you. Many of Leonard's early photographs seem in line with postmodern aesthetics as they focused on institutions and structures of knowledge, categories of representation, museums, libraries, maps, models, cartographies, aerial images, spatial overviews. But what works against and ultimately betrays this representational model of Leonard's early work as what was called in postmodernist criticism pictures is the overarching photographic form of these works, the borrowed or appropriated photographic aesthetic of these early pieces. Printed by the photographer herself, consistently full frame with the negative border showing in every print, pinned under glass when displayed like physical specimens, with dimensionality and physical presence underlined, the work simultaneously embraced a photographic model of the precarious, the anti-masterful, or the minor, an aesthetic of de-skilling within photography that has to do with accepting the photograph as subject to accident, to flaws, to mistakes. There is a general air of the anti-technical that manifests itself most strongly in the image's persistent darkening grain, in the consistent play with inconsistent over and under exposure, and then, of course, in the acceptance of a general stylization in Leonard's images that seems consistently blurred. I want to assert, of course, that this style the artist embraced, this kind of image that Leonard evolved, proposed itself as a kind of return or atavism, a repetition looking back and reconnecting with a specific genealogy of the photograph, rethought, remembered, and for our time. One could trace the genealogy, of course, of the flaw in photography and photo history, the model of the photographic amateur and the anti-technical photographic image in a host of different ways. The art historian Carol Armstrong has imagined an entire genealogy of the flaw linked to the work of women photographers and looking back from the work of Diane Arbus to Tina Modotti, figures like Gertrude Kasebier or Juliet Margaret Cameron. In this model, Armstrong's focus has been on the physical and even bodily, also chemical nature of photography, an intensification of what has been understood as the medium's indexicality. We face a privileging of the trace, of process, of the liquids involved in photography, a story upending most priorities of canonical photo histories in its embrace of the chemical side of the medium over the medium's optical parameters. And if the chemical nature of the photograph is precisely what has been voided today in the current shift to the digital, there is a sense of urgency to this genealogy Armstrong has traced, the alternate lineage of women photographers that she's been prioritizing. Now, too quickly, this is going to be brutal, because I only have about 7 or 8 minutes left. Too quickly, I want to claim that Leonard's early photographs point us toward a different, and actually differently urgent, genealogy. The blurred image is, of course, primarily about focus or about motion. It produces an analogy, I want to claim, to a weakening or now distant human vision. It imagines or reimagines a way of seeing and of seeing photographically. Quite simply, the genealogy of the blurred image that I want to trace in the history of photography, the out of focus and the imprecise, compels us to rethink the optics of the photographic image, the optical side of the chemical-optical divide in the photograph's history. And for the same reasons, and at the same moment of intensity, as someone like Carol Armstrong's account. In Leonard's precarious and contingent photographs, we see the embrace of a long history of photography contemplating the breakdown of the visual from within, and imagining a form of photographic seeing thus gone bad, or a photographic optics suddenly become wrong. The key moments in Leonard's atavistic genealogy and these moves would be three, as I see this, at least three. Bear with me, this is brutal, but it's just a heuristic device. First, her early images seem to evoke the first primitive attempts at photography, the most common form, I would want to claim, of a kind of photographic atavism that we see in contemporary art today. Whether we look at Niepce or Talbot or Daguerre, in the earliest photographs, the blur attests to the technical limitations of the medium. Indeed, in the origin images, the photograph could only be experienced as what I want to call a limited, precarious entity, not yet technologically triumphant, surely not everlasting, the museum knows this all too well, and also not fixed for all time. We sense in Leonard's images this kind of atavism, a return to the origin images, barely emerging, struggling into visibility, struggling then against the full technical challenge that photography originally presented, at the precise moment now of the triumph of technique represented by the digital. To reconnect to the first photographs today is then to attempt to recover this precariousness itself, to think photography as involved in a kind of contingent seeing or vision, and thus a fungible image, a vastly different model of the photograph. A second genealogical moment, of course, would be the anti-machinic images of pictorialism, where the blur came to encompass the first experience, I would claim, already of photographic atavism, a first experience already of turning back against the tide of technology and modernity both, a drive to recapture something lost. The blur in pictorialism, the play with the gum bichromate process, was meant to evoke the art status of painting and the brushstroke, sure, we're familiar with the story. But importantly for my purposes, it also gives testament to a key moment in which we sense photography reaching for, opening itself up to other mediums and other forms, becoming itself in this process, although this hasn't been the claim most photo historians and critics have made for pictorialism, what I want to call an open form. But there is an allegory of the subject and a desire in such opening of one form up to another was often signaled in pictorialism's themes themselves, themes of love and eros above all. And such was one of the great underappreciated achievements of pictorialism we only now are in a position, I think, to comprehend. Clearly, the grain and blur in pictorialism has also been understood as the mark not just of art status, but of the artist, him or herself. As opposed to scale, however, it finds itself embodied in what will come to become, in fact, the photographic equivalent of de-skilling. And here its full paradoxical nature emerges. More than the mark of the artist, the blur in pictorialism comes to embody the trace of subjectivity, of hand and body in the machinic apparatus. And this gets folded into the aesthetic's general concern with a photographic image connoting pastness and memory themselves. The burgeoning forth of subjectivity now becomes the legacy of the blurred image, the sign of the backwardness of the memory image in the history of photo. Its apotheosis, I then want to claim, arrives with the anti-technical images of the New York School, my third genealogical moment, and the photographs most closely, of course, tied to Leonard's own appropriations. From teacher figures like Alexei Brodovich and Sid Grossman, passed down to figures like William Klein or Paul Himmel, the blur in the New York School now self-consciously turned the new small format cameras and the play with movement and exposure times into the signs of not just authorship, but subjective expression. Similarly, the openness of photography to other forms, as in pictorialism, was continued, perhaps exacerbated. Its key referent shifted, however, from a fraught comparison with painting now to cinema and narrative forms. You sense the model I'm exploring, I'm sorry to say, but it, you know, it's clear that it has to be admitted, is as far from Los Angeles and California as I can get, from the F64 group, for example, from figures like Weston or Adams, and that history of technical and photographic perfection. Though Leonard had always mentioned figures like Lisette Model or Diane Arbus as key for her development, I personally want to attach my remarks on the New York School to Sid Grossman, a hero of mine and someone just now beginning, I think, to get his due. In the opening pages of the posthumous collection of his images that was published as the book Journey to the Cape, Grossman's verbal collaborator, Millard Lampel, allegorized the breakdown of the visual that I'm here contemplating. In fact, the first words of Grossman's photo collection simply read, quote, "We all carry our share of blindness. We are born blind, and in a week or two, our eyes grope into fleeting focus. We see a dim shape. We see a moving shadow," end quote. And we see much more, I think, than a kind of painterly expressionism in the New York School's exploration of accident, chance, and the blurred image. We face the fraught moment when photography confronts its potential transformation, in fact, from an individual vision, what the photographer Helen Levitt called a way of seeing, to a mode and model of openness and desire, a photographic vision as both self-consciously contingent and limited and thus connected to what's beyond it, to the unknown, to otherness, the phenomenon to which Leonard would come, in fact, to dedicate her work, the shift of the photographic object to a more general mode of subjectivity and to an ethics in its way. This achievement of Leonard's early photographs brings us back to the present, and here I'm about to conclude in 2 minutes. To the artist's most recent work in the wake of analog. We can now understand and position anew the recent work's focus on the optics, I would say, of photography, and on an alternate and resistant genealogy of the same. For, of course, Leonard's camera obscura installations, and here I'm showing you now the one that was recently at the Whitney, are premised on a form of photography sundered from its chemicals, returning atavistically to the moment before the chemistry of the medium developed, but at the precise moment now, of course, of its eclipse. The camera obscura pieces prioritize instead the work of the lens and of light simply inhabiting space, with optics and seeing explored now for their own sake, creating a new artistic model of literal being or existing in the photographic as a space, as it were, and a form of being there with others, as if a new form of photography's insistence on openness and connectedness was exactly what was desired. Leonard's sun images, made simultaneously, reconnect even more directly to her earliest works, and the genealogy of atavism, of course, I've just traced. Literal bad photographs shot into the sun, breaking one of the most basic technical rules of good photography, quote unquote, but also potential images of madness or even pain as well, the subjective connotation of staring into the sun. The work also prioritized the condition of light behind the light writing of the photograph. It's a photography of light that emphasizes, again, the optical side of the medium, but in a new and problematized way, images of emotions and fundaments simultaneously. For these blurred and imprecise images have gone now literally to a point beyond. They're almost abstract images in their way, without a subject, but only by returning to origins and to the source atavistically, pointing forward and pointing back toward a beyond and toward an origin, simultaneously again, first images and last. The horizon, then, of Leonard's camera obscura works and sun photographs is the loss of the chemical basis of the analog image. It's in part the triumph of the digital to which they react, in part, at least that. But the conditions of this massive shift, the triumph of the optics of the photograph, of what a photography curator once said to me, makes the digital continuous with all photography that's come before it, that it's basically we confront now the triumph of lens-based aesthetics alone. That was Peter Galassi, I'll just name names. Of a medium of digitized light, here give on to new forms in Leonard's work of experience through the return paradoxically of the old. For instead of the conditions of the digital image, we face an art now in Leonard's camera obscura works of phenomenological presence, of temporal extension, and observational intensification in these works, the precise opposite of digital dematerialization and such images' endless fungibility. The Leonard camera obscura works imagine a new and vivid connection to the physical world, paradoxically though, as image. And if the sun images return to the source of photography and show it endlessly changing, different, and ultimately elusive, its transformation remains a condition of specific conditions of the physical world and the situation of the photographer and the camera. We face a third path, I think, between two increasingly prevalent options. I'm thinking of younger photographers like Ryan McGinley, who've embraced the anti-technical photograph as their own, producing, however, an endless simulacrum of spontaneity, an endlessly staged return to the body and also to nature. Or something like the artist, the filmmaker Hito Stiles, exploration of the digital explosion of what she's come to call in her now very important essay in defense of the poor image, poor images. Images that are subjected and given over in the digital moment to the necessities of transport, quantity, and speed. For Leonard's poor images show us what cannot be seen. That which is behind the photographic medium, that which is behind vision itself, the source of light, itself unrepresentable. The photographs become then a sign, we could say, for a photograph that aims to push toward a beyond of vision and sight, of light, of all the basic conditions then of photography itself, and far from the digital's annihilation of some of these former modes of the photographic image. So let me end then simply with a title. It's the appropriated phrase that Zoe Leonard borrowed for her archive of appropriated postcards of the tourist attraction and landscape of Niagara Falls. It's a phrase she found scrawled on the back of a card that was part of this massive photographic collection. "You see, I'm here after all," the card simply exclaimed to a lover or to a friend. And the work then by Leonard was named, installed at the Dia Foundation in 2008. I just want to break down this phrase quite simply, because it seems to break down quite easily, into three separate statements, all about photography. Three credos in a borrowed voice from the past that seem now to be the artist's own as well. They underline a photography that prioritizes vision and observation above all, but also physical co-presence in the here and now, and all of this with the condition of a photography looking back, confronting history, lateness, aftermath. And so I'll just break it down as I end. You see, I'm here after all. So thank you. going to go to Amanda. She's saying, cut it short. No questions are allowed. I hate that, but maybe in discussions some things can come up later. But thank you very much.
Thank you, George, and good morning, everyone. My name is Amanda Maddox. I'm an assistant curator here in the Department of Photographs, and I want to thank you all for coming this morning, and hopefully you will make it through the day. It's a very long day. Before we get to panel one, I just have a few announcements. When you came in, you received a ticket. And you're going to need to hold on to that ticket throughout the day. It's your re-entry into the auditorium. If you decide to leave after any of the panels or at lunchtime, please just hand over your tickets when you exit so that other people can sit, because we do have people kind of coming and going today. And for those of you who do endure the entire day, we're going to reward you with a wine reception at 5:30. So hang in there. Today I will be introducing all of the moderators for every panel, who will in turn introduce each panelist. We will be taking questions after this panel, panel one, and again at the end of the day at panel three. So hang on to your questions. Please raise your hand when it's time for questions. And we have visitor services staff who will be assisting with microphones. Don't blurt out your question, please. Please wait for a mic when you're called upon. And lastly, I have some unfortunate news to relay. As you can see from the panelists who are seated here, Kathy Opie is not among them. Unfortunately, she is very ill. She has no voice. And so John Davola has kindly stepped in to serve in her place. It will be the John Davola show today. So thank you, John. We're incredibly grateful. John can talk about everything. So first, our first moderator is a tour de force. When Ann Tucker arrived at the Museum of Fine Arts Houston in 1976 to establish the Department of Photographs there, the collection included 141 prints. Today, the museum has over 29,000 photographs, all thanks to Ann. It is widely recognized as one of the finest photographic collections anywhere, and of course, part of that is due to the inclusion of 4,000 works from the Manfred Heiding collection. Over the course of her career, Ann has curated more than 40 exhibitions. These include Czech Modernism, 1900 to 1945, the first major exhibition in the US to explore creativity in pre- and post-war Eastern Europe, the History of Japanese Photography, a personal favorite of mine, which showcased the rich tradition of photographic practice in Japan, and most recently, War Photography, Images of Armed Conflict and Its Aftermath, a groundbreaking examination of war through the eyes of photographers. And I think for that show, Ann traveled to just about every continent to make that show possible. And hopefully many of you who are based in LA were able to see it here at the Annenberg Space for Photography. She has also authored dozens of publications, including the War Photography Catalog, which received the prestigious 2013 Krasnikraus Book Award for the Best Photography Book. Ann was named America's Best Curator by Time Magazine in 2001. In June 2015, so in just 1 year, Ann will retire from the MFA in Houston, at which point she will leave behind an unparalleled legacy. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome me. Please join me in welcoming Ann Tucker and panel one.
Good morning. Since this panel is dedicated to education in Southern California largely, the structure will be that the panelists have each chosen some images to be shown in a PowerPoint. I'm going to give rather longer introductions than usual, or might, because I think it's really important to understand that although there is a distinguished teaching career associated with every person on this panel, every single one of them has continued to be productive and esteemed artist. They have continued to practice their art as well as to commit the time and thought and energy that it takes to be a teacher and run a program. In chronological order, Jo Ann Callis was born in Cincinnati and first studied art at the Ohio State University for 2 years before marrying and moving to a suburb of Los Angeles. As a mother of two sons, she pursued her art, drawing small sculpture and collages at home in the evenings and on weekends. In 1970, she returned to school full-time and enrolled at UCLA, receiving a BA in 1974 and an MFA in 1977. Robert Heinecken encouraged her to experiment and led her to understand that things in different contexts could have a whole new meanings. In 77, Callis began to use color materials for additional emotive force color might bring. At this time, color was just beginning to gain recognition and acceptance in photographic art circles, as were the moments that were fabricated to be photographed. For Callis, it was the discovery of Paul Otteridge's photographs that also opened her early corridors of exploration. She had a show at G. Ray Hawkins in tandem with Otteridge in 1981. Although throughout her career, she has maintained a fascination with the power of objects, her love of painting and sculpture, a faith in ambiguity, and an embrace of sensuality and eroticism and their eternal dance with death and melancholy. Her first one-person show was in her senior year at UCLA in 1985. She had a one-person show at the Temporary Contemporary. Her first retrospective survey, Objects of Reverie, Selected Photographs, 1977 to 89, was organized by the Des Moines Art Center in 1989. And most recently, Woman Twirling was featured here at the J. Paul Getty Museum. Solo exhibitions have included exhibitions throughout the United States and Japan, as well as many important two-person exhibitions, largely with Southern California contemporaries. She's received a Ferguson grant from the Friends of Photography in 78, fellowships from the National Endowment for the Arts in 80, 85, and 91, awards from the Visual Art in 89, and a Guggenheim fellowship in 90. She taught at the California State University at Fullerton in 1977-78, but primarily she has served on the faculty of the California Institute for the Arts from 76 to the present. Henceforth, I shall just refer to it as CalArts and the other as UCLA. And it's important to recognize that all of the panelists have had associations with one or both of those important institutions. John DiVola was born in 1949 at Santa Monica and grew up in the San Fernando Valley. Given a camera at a young age, he was the school photographer in high school, but attributed his motivation to being a passport out of class. He received his BFA in photography from California State University Northridge in 71, and both MA and MFA from UCLA in 73 and 74, respectively. Of his days at UCLA, he commented that nobody working with photography at UCLA Art Department seemed particularly interested in working with a camera. While DiVola has used a camera for the past four decades, he has also employed his awareness of conceptual practices, a role of performance, altered environments, fabricated structures, and chance in making photographic imagery. Among the recurring themes are the dialogue between the environment and nature, abandoned, condemned houses, and modestly fabricated dwellings, as well as human actions within and against those structures, by his own acts and those of others, some random, some deliberated. There are psychological components in his art that include melancholy, anger, and the anxieties of absence, as well as deadpan humor. DiVola's work has been recently featured in three concurrent exhibitions of 10 of the major series of his work at the Santa Barbara Museum, LACMA, and the Pomona College. And these were all published in the book, John DiVola, As Far As I Could Get. Among other one-man shows were those in Germany, in Arles, and numerous museums and galleries in the United States. He was represented in the 1981 Whitney Biennial and 1975 Netherlands Photo Biennial. Among his books and catalogs was also the book Three Acts, published by Aperture in 2006. His grants and fellowships include the Rome Prize in 2004, which he declined, the Cola Grant in 99, CalArts Council Grant, Flint Ridge Foundation, National Endowment Fellowships in 73, 76, 79, and 90, a Mellon Fellowship, and a Guggenheim Fellowship in 86. He taught at CalArts between 78 and 88, and at UC Riverside since 1988. Robert Flick was born in Amersfoort, Holland in 1939, began to photograph at age 8. He lived briefly with his family in the Dutch West Indies and developed a nation where his interest in nature intensified. He moved with his family in Vancouver in 1958 and received a BA in Fine Arts from the University of British Columbia in 1967, becoming a member of the vanguard avant-garde scene, working with architects, dancers, poets, and filmmakers in early experiments in multimedia. In the late 60s, enabled by a Connecticut Council grant to study photography in Los Angeles, he enrolled briefly at Art Center College of Design before a chance encounter with photographer Robert Heineken. The way he was thinking and talking about photography made sense to me, said Flick, who received both an MA and an MFA from the University of California at UCLA. Flick accepted his first teaching job at the University of Illinois, Champaign-Urbana in 1971, where he produced his black and white studies of Midwestern cornfields and wintry wastelands. In 1976, he returned to LA to teach at the University of Southern California, where he built a department to an increasingly larger staff, and soon recognized the need for a program that went beyond photographing with film. He established USC's Matrix Digital Photo Lab, and then this lab has morphed into the UC Roeske International Division. In 2004, the Los Angeles County Museum organized his first major retrospective, Trajectories, photographic work of Robert Flick. Other exhibitions have been held at the International Center in New York, Photography in New York, National Museum of Art, Smithsonian, Center for Creative Photography, and other distinguished museums and galleries. He's a John Simon Guggenheim Memorial Fellow, a Getty Scholar, a two-time National Endowment recipient, and was awarded the Cola Grant. While a student at UCLA, Flack produced the series LA Diary. Since returning to LA in 76, the city of Los Angeles has become an enduring source of inspiration. There was something about Los Angeles, said Flick, just a promise. To me, Los Angeles was the future. LA Times critic Christopher Knight wrote that what Ansel Adams did for Yosemite, Los Angeles photographer Robert Flick did for a parking garage in Inglewood. In 1979, he was invited to become part of the documentary project for the Los Angeles Bicentennial and began to photograph specific neighborhoods, one street at a time. He then began his first foray at sequence landscapes to the flowering of his signature style. James Welling was born in 1951 and began to work with the first series of instructors in art at age 12. Between 69 and 71, he attended the Carnegie Mellon Institute in Pittsburgh, where he began to photograph in 1970. In 71, he transferred to the recently formed CalArts at the Valencia campus, where he worked primarily in video. John Baldessari was an important influence, and from 73 to 74, during his graduate studies, Welling was Baldessari's teaching assistant. In 78, he moved to New York, and his images from series produced at this time became part of a generational questioning of photography by artists who came of age in the 70s, a group subsequently tagged the Pictures Generation. Welling has exhibited extensively both nationally and internationally, museums, galleries, biennials, art festivals such as Documenta 9 and the Whitney Biennial. His first retrospective exhibition, James Welling Photographs in 1974 to 99, originated at the Wexler Center in Columbus, Ohio, In 2002, a substantial retrospective opened at the Palais des Beaux-Arts in Brussels. A major survey entitled James Welling Monograph was held at the Cincinnati Art Museum in 2013. A period of projects in Europe, begun in 1968, included the publication of his first three books, and there have been numerous publications on series as well as his retrospective catalog since then. After teaching at MIT and at Bard, in 1995, Welling moved to LA to head the photography department at UCLA. He has acknowledged that teaching at UCLA profoundly changed his relationship with photography, and that Heineken's proclivity to make photograms was a factor in his own future work. His grants and awards include a National Endowment for the Arts grant, New York's Foundation for the Arts grant, the 1999 Deutsche Bank Photo Prize in Photography, and in 2009 he received the AICA Award for Excellence of Best Show in a Commercial Gallery. Welling's work has been distinctive for its questions of process and material, its rapidly shifting technical choices, and his preference for subterfuge over unmediated directness. So I would like to welcome our guests today. I'm going to ask a series of questions, of which I have mostly conveyed to the panelists. I want to start with asking each of us to comment as they wish, or wish not, on two figures who have loomed large in Southern California, particularly in Southern California education, and that is Robert Heineken and John Baldessari. Bob Heineken started teaching at UCLA in 1963, and John Baldessari began teaching at CalArts in 70, moving to the Valencia campus in 71. He taught there until he moved to UCLA in 86, where he taught until 2008. We'll just go down the list and start. Joanne? I'll start a different end, so you won't get picked on everything.
You want to ask a specific question?
I want to ask about either your response to the importance to you or in general of either of those two figures.
Well, Bob Heineken changed my life, so I start with him. I didn't know how to photograph before I met him. I took his class because I heard he was good and because I thought I should learn to use a camera. Being an art major, I had never looked at fine art photography until I met him, and suddenly this whole world opened up because of him. He had great charisma. He had students surrounding him always. He maintained an air, like a mystique around himself, but he was totally there and giving, and I learned how to appreciate what people were doing to understand their work from where they were coming from. As an example, there was a workshop called Nude in the Landscape. And soon after I learned to photograph, this was the summer of 74, we were in Yosemite, and so it was the time of free love sex, rock and roll, etc. And Eiko Hosoi was there, Lucian Clare, Imogen Cunningham, Wynn Bullock, Twinka was there. It was just this flowering, opening up of people and conversation, and everyone was shooting each other and models and so on. So that was like, wow, this is a great medium to be in. And I found a way that I could express what was going on in my life in photography in a way I hadn't in sculpture or painting. So there was a man that showed his work, some amateur girly camera club photos, and I thought, oh, he's gonna slam into him, you know. These are cliched or whatever. And he was so supportive, you know, he just got it where it was coming from and took it from there, showed him how he could think about different things the next time he saw a new model, and you know, and so I just, this compassion that he had was noteworthy, and I think I've tried to you know, you kind of teach what you were taught, and so he taught me that, and I've tried to do that in my own teaching, to kind of connect with people on a one-to-one basis, even in the classroom. I just find that so interesting. And so he was hugely influential. And I actually started teaching 2.5 years after I learned f-stops, so I was completely at a loss, but Heineken actually gave me a notebook of his notes from teaching, which I still have someplace. So I thought, wow, this is great. But of course, what good does it do you? Because these are all Heineken. It's nothing without him doing it, but it still, it gave me something to hang on to at the beginning. So he was brilliant, and he knew how to look at a photograph and how to read it. And you know, I made so much work at that time, because first of all, it was a new flowering for me. I was getting divorced, and I was, you know, exposed to this other world at school and so on. And I just lost my train of thought. But thank you.
Talking about making new work.
Oh yeah, so I made all this work, and I made sure that I set up things and made these new pictures every week, so that he would talk to me and talk about my work. So it was a great incentive, you know, pay attention to me. Look, I've got new photos, so every week I could be in the critique, which were, I mean, they were incredible. I felt like he was looking inside of me, like no other teacher had done or critiqued my work before that. I just thought, wow, how does he know this stuff about me? You know, so very insightful. And what can I say?
Well, he was obviously important to me as well. I went to UCLA. I actually went to UCLA 1 year as an undergraduate, my third year as an undergraduate, and I just reminded Robert a few months ago that he was a TA in my undergraduate class. He didn't remember me, and there's no reason he should have. But as Joanne was saying, Heineken had a kind of amazing democracy of spirit and interest in terms of looking at things. He didn't have a kind of ideology that he was trying to apply to you. He had a way of accepting work. And looking back in retrospect, in terms of his own work, and a lot of teaching is sort of modeling in a certain way. You know, you research universities, you hire the most interesting kind of practitioner in whatever field it is. And one thing that Heineken sort of, you know, most photography is about observation in some way, but and so Heineken sort of, I think, was a very early person to extend this notion of observation to this kind of envelope of representations, cultural representations. And I think when most people talk about postmodernism, they talk about it academically in terms of sort of wanting to address the conditions of reception that the viewer is bringing and the ideologies that the viewer is bringing. But I think in Heineken's case, he was sort of extending his own kind of subjective responses to those images the same way another photographer would or another artist would, using a camera, would apply it to something seen in the world. And so they were kind of indistinguishable for him, or there was a kind of, you know, whether you saw it in the world or whether you saw it on a screen or whether you saw it in a magazine, there was a kind of equivalence. And if I look back at my own practice, I can see that that's integrated. I never remember him ever saying anything about it, and I actually don't ever remember him saying anything theoretical at all.
Exactly.
And he certainly never said anything technical, because I remember when I got out of school, I had to teach. And I remember sitting by a pool reading a photo textbook, and I was amazed, like at all these technical things, like depth of field, really, you know, any of that stuff, you know. So, and also allow me to apologize for not being Kathy Opie right off the bat. I'll move it on to Roger.
Yeah, so I was your TA?
You were, yeah.
Well, I met Bob Heineken just by chance, sheer chance, in 67, something like that. I was at Art Center and basically quite unhappy in terms of what was going on there. The one really good thing I learned from Art Center was how to produce work. My God, they just had you produce 100, 150 prints a week. you know, regardless. And but the conversation wasn't quite there. There were a couple of people who were extraordinary. But then by chance I heard about Bob Heineken, and so I started sitting in his classes. And it was amazing to watch this man spend extraordinary precision and attention looking at something and embracing it and then exploring it. And in that process of exploration, you would, as a maker, you would feel drawn in, whether you were photographing toy cars or flowers or naked ladies. It was always a very close scrutiny of the parts. And one of the things that I've always carried with me is a statement he once made, you know, if once you see it, you will see it everywhere, which is so totally appropriate to that way of looking at the work. There is this demand of scrutinizing the particulars and then opening it up. And I think that opening it up part is also crucial in terms of the kind of community that he created around himself and that became the kind of community that at that time was Los Angeles. There were no galleries, there were almost no galleries. There was a way in which there was a network of individuals and we shared information. It was a community. And if people are interested in exploring that aspect of the community further, I would recommend that they have a look at The Collectible Moment, which is a book that was just recently done by the Norton Simon Museum, and that Gloria William Sanderson, the curator, put together. There are a series of essays by Fred Parker, by Daryl Curran, by Robert Fichter, by Mike Stone. All of these initial people that were working together or that had come together to look at photographs in a way that was refreshing, but was also totally of this time. The importance of it, of a practice that was happening specifically at a particular moment in time, which was open-ended. And Bob really allowed that to happen and made that work. There's much more that can be said about this. You know, Peter Bunnell has to be drawn into this as well, but that's another journey. But an extraordinary teacher.
And you knew Baldessari better yes. than anyone, so.
But I did meet Heineken once. When I started at UCLA, he was leaving, and I went over to his house for brunch. And the important difference between Heineken and Baldessari is about 2 feet. About 2 foot height difference. So I didn't really know Heineken, but when I started at UCLA, I was amazed when I looked at the dark rooms. Yeah. This describes something about Heineken's practice. There were individual dark rooms. Most photography programs have what's known as a gang dark room, where everyone works in a big room. And you have these little partitions, and you process your prints in a kind of common big tray of developer. But at UCLA, everyone had an individual dark room. So you could do whatever you wanted in that dark room. And the thing I did not like about gang dark rooms was that people could see what I was doing. So I never really flourished in that kind of environment. But at UCLA, when I took over, I saw everyone had their own individual dark room. So this kind of described, just in terms of the physical plant, something about Heineken that I was able to figure out. Baldessari was listening to the description of Heineken's kind of generosity and openness, John was, you know, shared those traits. I was, as a student, I really didn't care what my teachers thought of my work, so Baldessari was perfect, because he didn't really say much about your work. He was just very casual, whatever you wanted to do. I think it was probably a terrible environment for people who wanted to get something specific from the teacher, but John was generous and encouraging, so he had a number of students in the class who were just working away and doing things, and he would bring in books and catalogs and show us things. Very laid back teacher.
traveled a lot, so we would frequently be left on our own without John. Remember that, the absent father. But John would do things like he would come into class and say, "Let's put a camera on a dog," and he just had gotten a remote, a wireless remote for his 35 millimeter Nikon. So we put a camera on a dog and saw what a dog would see. It was kind of boring, but it was that kind of exploration. Or we would go out on field trips and pass the camera around and take pictures. But John really, it wasn't really a photography class because we were doing other things, performance, video, his post-studio art class, as it became known. Photography was just one of the things that you could do, and I think a number of people didn't make photographs. I gravitated toward photography, but that wasn't my primary medium. At that point, it was video. So John was, kind of transmedia or beyond media. But in his work at that time, he had started to make a lot of photographs, making sequential pictures, big arrays of pictures, and that was also, I was very interested in what was going on in his studio, so I'd go down and see what he was doing in the studio, because that was the only place to see his work. He really wasn't showing in Los Angeles at that point. He kind of had it with LA and was showing a lot in Europe, and it wasn't until later that he began to show in Los Angeles. But I kept track of what he was doing by visiting his studio.
That's actually something I want to come back to, because in 83 I did a show that had a lot of the conceptual photographers in it, and I realized that all of the West Coast people, Baldessari, Gubler, Anton, they showed in Europe. They certainly didn't show in New York. None of them had shows in New York. And many of them didn't have that many shows here in the West Coast, but they had a rich and powerfully influential presence in Italy, in Antwerp, in Amsterdam, and in Cologne. And so it was an interesting, having to sit and do. Now this is 83, I got my first computer, which will also come up in terms of this, because I heard there was this thing that if you deleted a footnote, it renumbered. And I thought, I want that. But John didn't have a bibliography. Other artists sent me something. John sent this bibliography that said, show Italy, spring. Show Amsterdam, fall. So I sat through art magazines at the art, and just literally created John's bibliography, which for years he Xeroxed. We send it out to others. Okay, because you have been at both schools and based on a conversation we had before, I'd like for you to talk a little bit about the importance of the fact that at CalArts there were departments, and at UCLA, it was an art school in which photography was a focus, and your perceptions of that, and then we'll come back for others,
When we were speaking on the phone, I was, since I was in the art school, I didn't really have much contact with the photography department at UCLA, and I'm not sure, is it a department, Joanne? Is it a department?
We're all under the art program.
Yeah.
Then there's art, graphics, and then photography, but they're all in the art general, but there's still some separation between them, but between graphics is really pretty separate, but between art and photography there's a lot of blending and a lot of interaction.
Yeah. When I was at CalArts, I was in the art, studying with Baldessari. I had no contact apart from one photographer, Marcia Resnick, but in general I was completely separate from photography and I doubt that many of Baldessari's students went over, went to the photo lectures and things, so it was kind of separate. UCLA now, I teach in an art department, so everyone has to take photography classes at an undergrad level, so there's a big mixture of painters taking photo classes and photo people having to make sculptures, things like that. But at CalArts, I think it was a little bit, more separate. I think if you were in photo, it was a
It changed.
Four-year program.
It's changed. But,
pedagogically, I accept into the grad program a number of students who go to the four-year photo programs, like Bard or Mass College or CCA. But at UCLA, it's a mixture. It's a BA program. So just pedagogically, it's the undergrad is sort of run a little bit different than the grad program.
Barbara, we can come back to media, but since both of you have been a long time at different colleges before, though, too, we can open it up, you know, to where you're each teaching as well in terms of that approach to the photo department, because as we all know, over time, you know, the shift of whether you call yourself a photographer or an artist, the whole shift of galleries, that whole shift. I mean, Cindy Sherman has never called herself a photographer. John never called himself a photographer, you know. But I'd like to talk about that, how you teach in that sense of students and photographs and, you know, stepping back a little bit and coming into the educational scene, college scene in Southern California, you know, relative to your own experiences, of course.
Are you addressing me?
Yes, I am.
Okay. I think there are two great differences between teaching within a university situation and within an art school situation. Within the university situation, you are generally open to completely different ways of looking and thinking about things. I have engineers, I have social scientists, geographers, philosophers, English students, and art students. And that raises the stakes, both in terms of the expectations that are being placed upon you of what it is that you're going to teach, and what the subject of what it is that you're going to be teaching within photography. And many of the students that are coming in will have a very specific set of assumptions. They will be journalists, or they will be such and such, or fashion photographers, or something like that. And then suddenly they jump into or fall into this fine arts related moment. And that's both extremely unsettling, but also very much a possibility of opening up. So within the university system, you have there's a hierarchy of steps that you have to go through. And the students will take those. And the kind of conversations that happen will be conversations that are not necessarily fine arts related. They're generated by the group of people that are there and the attention that is being focused on something that has been emerging. In a sense, it's still, for me, an extension of what Bob is doing.
Do you have both undergraduate and graduate?
Yes. The graduate program is a completely different program. It doesn't have the separation of media. In the undergraduate program, there is a separation of media, although that even is breaking down because of digital media and time-based media and so on.
And so presumably, once at the graduate level, they are declared fine art. You don't have that diversity that you have in the undergraduate?
They're graduate students in fine arts. And they have a very particular set of courses that they will take, but it is whatever their intentions are within a fine arts situation that's going to be emphasized. And so we may have photographers, and we will have painters, and we have sculptors, and we have intermediate people. And then we have people that you would be almost impossible to label because they're so wonderfully diverse and yet focused.
Well, I think things have just gradually been changing. When I taught at CalArts, photography was an entirely separate program. It didn't make any sense then at all, I don't think. But it was a distinct, as Jim was describing, distinctly separate. And so even though I taught with Baldessari, I didn't spend very much time with him, and I didn't really know him very well, whereas Joanne and I carpooled, so I knew her very well. And where I teach now, UC Riverside has the advantage of being a kind of newer program. So it's completely non-media specific. So even as an undergraduate, you would not declare yourself as a painter or a photographer, even though there are courses and sequences of courses that are defined by media. There's also sequences of courses that are non-media specific. And then we have a very small graduate program. We just take the most interesting artists that apply. And even since we have a kind of emphasis, a historical emphasis in photography, it leans a little photographically. But people often come in doing one thing, end up doing something else by the time they leave. So in our school, I don't know how it goes at UCLA, but it used to be at UCLA, the admissions, for example, in graduates, at UCLA it was that way too, that we all voted, except that Robert would tell us to give more votes when I taught at UCLA to the photo people. Give all the photo people tens, and so. Admissions has something to do with it too, because sometimes admissions is compartmentalized in terms of graduate programs. At ours, it's ours, it's not. But a lot of this is very hard to change. You know, if you have an old program that's got a ceramics and a foundry I recently went up to San Francisco Art Institute, and Ansel Adams started that photo program. So, you don't walk in there and say, hey, change it, and the people self-select. The people go there want to go to a photo program. So I think there's a place for that, but I think that the obvious trajectory overall is the kind of non-media specificity.
Yeah, at CalArts, being an art school, not a university, we get to choose who our students are. We have admissions, we look at their portfolios. It's all mostly done on their work, what they submit. And there's much more of a blurring between art and the art program and photography now. And in fact, every few years it comes up, well, maybe we should get rid of photography because so many photographers, they come in making pictures, but they go to video or other media. They change what they're doing. And they still stay in the photo department or photo area because that's where they started. But they freely sign up with lots of different teachers. So there is some blurring. But there still is, for photography, this hierarchy, like the art program has better studios. Bigger studios, nicer studios, etc. And that's always been a bone of contention. So there's still some, but the question of why do we need photography now that there's this blurring, and it's sort of like Cindy Sherman is not called a photographer because she came up through the art people being criticized by them. And if you have a traditional photography background, then you were one of those. And so that still carries on, I think, a bit, but it is getting better, I think.
Yes. I must admit I was a little bemused to be invited to chair this panel. I haven't taught since the 70s, and I'm an East Coast person, I mean, don't tell that to people in Texas, but, I was trained by Newhall, Sarkowski, and Lyons, I'm curious about when you have students, what their expectations are in terms of what they will be doing, what the end goal is. Largely on the East Coast, it was the book. You have the tradition of Walker Evans and Robert Frank and then Joel Sternfeld and, down to Alex Soth, the sort of great American book tradition is so powerful in so many of the schools in the East. Partly because many of you all have worked large scale and the wall, the book, your art was not conducive to that kind of take a place, photograph it, but also relative to that is something you mentioned early on, and relative to that is the huge shift, because when many of you started teaching there were no galleries. There was not going to be an exhibition. So you might have been making for the exhibition wall, but in fact, there were very few places. That's so changed now, or at least the students think it's changed. They think they're going to go out and exhibit their work. And so I'm curious, you know, because James, you've been on the East Coast and the West Coast, although you were not with a community that was particularly that inclined. You were with people who were trying to break that mold. But I'd just like each of you to comment on that exhibition versus publication component of photography
as John mentioned, that photographers' studios weren't as large as the art school. Anyway, the idea of the physical plant, again, kind of at UCLA, it's a free-for-all. Photographers can have gigantic studios, painters can have small studios. It's like a lottery system. But I think the end product or the end goal today is, you know, the laminated inkjet print on the wall. It's not a book, and it would be rare to have someone who came in who was exclusively interested in bookmaking. And we do get students who are interested in, you know, putting books together. I think we have two out of our six who are, their theses next year could be a book or could be book presentations in a gallery. But, you know, mostly it's, you know, large prints, now inkjet prints, pretty much.
And this morning you were talking about you have graduate reviews tonight, and that some of the painting students will sell out in the open house for their graduate work?
Oh, maybe someone will sell a painting, but I predict that no photographs will sell. Well, maybe, I could be wrong.
maybe one little.
I don't want to jinx it, so maybe.
Did you think about a book? I mean, you came from a totally different place because you came from Europe via Canada to the West Coast. So.
Books? There were actually no books when I started out. By chance, I ran across the Americans and one Western monograph. And in terms of going to UCLA, we would be making, at Art Center you would make books because you were sequencing and it was something that you were trying to do for a particular project. But basically what we were working on then was just we were interested in articulating something, getting towards a place where something could be articulated. It tended to go into an installation situation, or it tended to go towards the wall, or it was a sculptural event, or it was simply an event. I'm thinking of what Alan Brooks was doing at in the early 70s, whereby she was making sculptures, photographic sculptures. I mean, the whole notion of the book, if you wanted to do that, you could, but there was really no way of doing it. You made prints. You had a conversation. There was an extended conversation. You shared work with other practitioners. It was that conversation that was there. And if you wanted to have a show, it was generally a group show. And if you wanted to curate something, you curated it, but you did not put yourself in it. It would be a curation of, because these are the ideas, these are the people that are working together, and you would find a space for it. And deeply ironic is that some of that is beginning to happen again. There are the alternative spaces that are developing now. Students are putting together these exhibitions again in a very similar manner that was happening in the late 60s, but with a very different kind of intent, I suspect. You mentioned possibilities of sales. I think that's underlying most of it. At the time, you could work for almost nothing because it didn't cost you that much. Anything that you produce today is seriously expensive.
John?
Well, I think the only gallery that showed photography was called Ohio Silver. It was
right.
In somebody's house on Ohio Street. And the chances that I was going to sell the photograph were zero, and the chances that somebody was going to publish my work in a book was even less. So there was no sense in my thinking that I was going to make a book.
But on the same token, the published image was very important to me. So since I didn't see any originals, I didn't even see original photographs. I just saw photographs in magazines and photographs in books. I remember Lee Friedlander's self-portrait book was like a revelation to me when I saw that book. So I very quickly came to this point of thinking that I was more interested in images than objects, and it's kind of ironic because I make big objects now and totally contradict that position. But I remember saying at the time, I want to make something you can send over a telephone, and it would, the essential nature of it would be intact and not be invested in its objectness. But you know, we had no opportunity. But now there's this resurrection or this renaissance of the photo book, and it actually makes much more sense right now to be interested in the idea of sequencing and associating images in a book, not only because you can do small run books, but simply because as a reaction to the virtualization of information, the objectness of books kind of takes on a new urgency for people, and people have a new level of interest in it that they didn't have before. But there was no sense thing. I actually remember my thesis exhibition, which was one little wall in the Grunewald Center. Like, I think I had like 14 feet. And the only feedback I got from that is I did these vandalism photographs, and there was this couple standing there looking at my work, and so I was trying to overhear them. And the woman said to the man, "Honey, I guess they let them do whatever they want." So, I mean, you did it because, like, a philosopher writes philosophy, you're interested in the essential subject and activity. It wasn't because you were projecting the end, like, destination for the activity.
No, I was going to say, why would you do this if you didn't just love making the pictures?
Right,
because
right. There
was not the reward. But, you know, G. Ray Hawkins started showing my work fairly early, and there were shows. You know, I remember packing up pictures and sending them to this show or that show. And sometimes there was a little catalog, but I never thought about making my own. It's very expensive, and that was just off the radar. So I wanted to make pictures.
One of the funnier stories I heard about magazines and seeing art was Robert Hughes was a painter in Australia before he was a critic in the United States. And he tells this funny story about how the art forum would arrive and they would devour it. And one time, it arrived, and I'm sorry, I've forgotten who the painter was, but it was an abstract expressionist, and there was a big white hole in one of the, you know, big white space, and so they all started putting these white spaces, and years later they found out it was a printing mistake. But they had no way of knowing, because
right. None
of the originals were reaching Australia.
Right.
We have very little time left, but I do want to get to new media, which is a major component now, and the blend, the division between photography and video and digital and what transmission and all of this. So, I think we need to, I had many more things I had hoped to think, but I think we have to at least touch on that in the time that we still have. I mean, Bob, you started the new media program.
What is happening at this point, or what I'm witness to, is this extraordinary situation where new media have surrounded Bob, and there's so much work out there that Roger and George was talking about that in his talk. It's the overwhelming and ease with which information can be gathered and consumed and then discarded that. What I recently was witnessing was that the change of towards something else, the need towards touching, the need towards making something tangible again. The future of it is, I think, is just extraordinary. But we're just in a very transitional moment, whereby we're both reaching back, like was already suggested, and reaching forward in a way that we have no idea what it will be like.
And you've made videos.
But I think, you know, well, right now most of the grad students in photo are primarily working either, as I said, a couple are making books and or, you know, put up apps on the wall. We don't really have new media, people doing video or interactive things. That's a whole separate department, which is kind of a parallel department to the art department, design, media, arts. And Kathy and I think in photo, we really try to choose picture makers because we're both interested, you know, very interested in the future of the picture. I think we've unsuccessfully had a couple of people who worked, came into the program working in video or new media. And I think we prefer to work with picture makers, people who still work with film or, you know, mostly film, digital capture. They're making inkjet prints. Very few people use our chromogenic processor, but we still have a RA4 processor. But it's primarily, and we select them. It's not like we're not aware of other activities, but I think we both want people who make pictures. Because that's the most exciting thing for us to talk about.
John, you
I don't exactly know what to say about it. As Jim says, I think most of the people I work with are indeed working in that mode, although people do a lot of installation that involves video, and installation become kind of combined in an interesting way. But I think, as Robert was pointing out, that we're in a really interesting transitional phase. It's very different. I think if I were 18, I'd be looking at the web and image harvesting and links and, I think of my daughter who's 15, and I recently had to transfer her phone to a new phone. She had 5,000 photographs on it. I never saw her even take a photograph. There's this like this kind of flood of imagery and imagery kind of integrated into living in kind of the in personal networking and communicating, that is really a fundamental shift that is inevitable to be central to art making. And I don't know that us up here are the right people to be talking about that, because we're of a different generation. And I've always actually been frustrated by how little of it is manifest within the context where I teach. But I think it's inevitable. I see it on the horizon. But it's difficult to facilitate. The structures in place don't really very effectively facilitate it.
I was thinking, I'm not into the digital either. Well, you are, but I'm not. But I think the book was never something I thought about, as I said. But this new resurgence of alternative processes is like it's suddenly new again. And when I first learned photography in 73, that was the rage, you know. Well, Heineken certainly was a leader, but there were many practitioners doing Van Dyke Brown and blueprints and gum bichromates. And then, of course, when photography was invented, there were those methods. But it's just like now it's resurged, like something new. And it feels like, oh, yeah, everyone was doing that then. But it fell away, and now it's back again.
So. Actually, we have cyanotypes in almost every decade in the collection. It's never gone away. It's only become, it's only in waves of recognition.
Exactly.
Do I turn something on here? Is this on?
Okay. It's on.
Many of us in the audience were here at the same time. I think you all recognize. I'm Leland Rice, and I'm not going to name anybody else in the audience, but many of us were active at this very same period. And I'm interested, there was a vacuum in this area, as we well know, between roughly 74 and 84. Pasadena Museum closed. 74, Simon took it over. The 84 is, of course, the birth of MoCA and this wonderful institution here. Many of you, Bob, I think of the exhibitions that you curated at USC, for instance, which many of us were in. We did a lot of things, you guys did a lot of things, other than teach and make work. And I wonder if any of you would like to comment on the kind of activities that really kind of acted as a kind of stitching all of this activity and things together, that you guys reached out to and were influenced by in the community. Thank you.
May I? Because what you're really hinting at is the existence of LACPS and Los Angeles Center for Photographic Studies, which was started in 74 by a former UCLA student. And which has become, or which was, an extraordinary exchange of ideas between people. The exhibition that you're referring to, at the tail end of the 70s, there were a number of exhibitions that were done here in Southern California. I did one, LECPS did one that was located in the banks, which had a catalog, by the way, and also had word processing, which was just unbelievable. And then Fred Parker did one up in Santa Barbara. So there was this kind of, the notion of the survey was floating around. One of the things that happens a lot, or has happened a lot in photography, we talked about cycles, but there was also a sense of a very particular set of questions that would start to emerge at very particular times, even when we didn't know about it. One of the most cleanest ones that I can think of is new topographics, whereby we were all working in a very particular manner, but didn't know about each other. So there were certain questions, and what happened in terms of what you're talking about, or what asking about, is that there were a large number of practitioners, both former students and artists who had nothing to do really with photography, who began to find ways to show work. Barnstall became a very important part of this. The examination of different questions of gender, different questions of the political questions. All of these things were happening simultaneously in that what you call the vacuum that we didn't talk about.
And also like a journalist, the first, yeah. I mean, even though it wasn't a photo publication, the first time I saw Judy Fiskin's work was on the cover. And I think Leland, you were on the cover of Like a Journal. It was a very important publication.
Yeah, it was Leica and Lace just shortly thereafter. And we must not forget the Women's Building and the extraordinary developments that happened there across the whole spectrum of Los Angeles and internationally. And then there's also the linkages with other institutions. We haven't really talked about that. But the fact that the relationships that existed were basically academically related situations. There was UCLA, there was the Orange Coast College, there was Art Central, though less so. There was CalArts, there was Chouinard before that, and Otis. And so there are these kind of linkages between places. The relationship with San Diego and what happened there, a different kind of mental mindset that was operating. All of this was brewing, and all of this was happening in a conversational sense. I don't think there was any kind of negativity going on. There was a constant support.
It's almost a lost decade in Los Angeles. I mean, when MoCA starts, then a different narrative is written, but this, you know, from 1970 until whenever MoCA starts is a kind of, you know, occluded, darker period, or less well-known.
Which is why I was, mentioned that the collectible moment, that the that was basically work that came out, that entered into the North Simon Museum collection. But what has happened there is there are these extraordinary reflections upon that, the early beginnings of that time period. And then later on, when the last picture show is coming to the Hammer, which is well beyond this time period, the reflections back, though, towards the artists that are practicing elsewhere come up.
Who else had questions? Down here?
And in the back, too.
Yeah.
Okay. My battery chose today to go out on my watch. So. And I don't have my phone, so what, you know.
I have an analog watch, and I'll keep you on schedule. Now, I was just curious to know about the effect of the increasing, the burgeoning, and then increasing institutional holdings, i.e. museum holdings of photography, the impact on the ways in which you taught, particularly, you know, the founding of the act of actual exhibition up at the Villa of the Getty Collection, LACMA's burgeoning collection, MOPA, how those collections actually aided, how much outreach was there from the institutions to the various programs with which you were associated?
Well, where I teach, we actually have a museum of photography at UC Riverside. So it's very easy for me to, every quarter, to take my students down there and have things pulled from the collection and go through them. It's much more difficult, frankly, you know, to go to the Getty Villa, you know, to get my, you know, even if my students didn't live in Riverside, they're not going to drive to the Getty Villa. So, you know, the graduate students are going to go to all those places on their own. They're motivated. Undergraduate students, it's much more difficult unless you have a kind of immediate adjacency to an institution to use those collections.
We weave it into the classes. In other words, the use of the institutions. What is so marvelous about having the having LACMA, having the Getty, and having Hammer here, both in terms of the actual experience of place and the actual experience of objects, but also of the blogs and the kind of archives that exists on the web. So there's a real interesting weaving that can take place at this point in time that didn't exist even 10, 15 years ago, whereby it was extremely difficult to get to the institution. I think also many of the institutions are open to a kind of outreach to academia. That used to be very hard. There was kind of a separation between things. And I think that has been that's easing off in quite an extraordinary and collaborative manner.
Shelley Rice teaches at NYU and told me that she assigned her students to go to pick a photograph in an exhibition at the Metropolitan, and she was quite stunned that more than half of the class wrote on the same two objects, and then she realized those were the two on the Met website. So all subsequent assignments had to do with anything that was not on the website, so that they would actually go uptown. You know, they had to go 80 blocks from NYU to the Met, so it was, you know.
And we used to do field trips. I mean, when I was teaching classes, I did a field trip where we didn't go so much into the archives, although I did do that once at the Getty. But other teachers on our faculty do that, and I think it's really valuable to see the work.
Do the CalArts students live in Valencia, or do they? I mean, that's a whole other phenomena. Are any of your schools campus living? Are students just commuting?
We do. Both.
You know,
we have those that live there, mostly undergrads, and then. But not all of the undergrads.
Because I was conscious when I was teaching at the University of Houston that I had to wait a few minutes because the students were still going 70 miles an hour when they walked into the classroom, you know, because they come from wherever in Houston and then came. But there's no repositories near Valencia.
No.
So they have to come. But I mean, I'm just seeing in terms of the difference of having them on campus.
Exactly.
James, do the students use, you have two UCLA institutions. You have the Hammer and also something on campus, right?
Well, we actually go to the Grunwald Center for Graphic Art, which is part of the Hammer, but it's a freestanding, it's in the same building, but it's not technically attached to the Hammer. They have a wonderful photo collection that we use.
And do the students go and look? I mean, is that?
No. I have to take them. You know, I think the reality is that one of the great things about teaching is that I can bring up someone's name in response to looking at someone's work, and we can go online and find a lot of interesting images. I mean, it's okay, it's not the same as even looking at a book, but it's a way of accessing immediately imagery. I think that's, as John was saying, I think, you know, in 20 years when we're all dead, and other people are talking about how images are looked at, it's going to be a whole different response. You know, the next two generations down. I'm not exactly sure what I'm saying about museums and, you know, photographs in collections, but there probably will be a much different relationship to the image. I think this transition that we represent on stage, going from, you know, the late 60s, sort of coming out of actually the work that George was kind of a New York school, that, you know, you were kind of evoking Zoe Leonard's work I think that New York School was what most of us reacted against. That kind of work was where we were departing from and creating new works in response to that sort of street photography. And I don't know if it's cyclical, but there's another re-energizing of those sorts of concerns, say in Zoe Leonard or Moira Davey. But I think, you know, the question about how images, photographs, pictures will look at, you know, in the future is, you know, an open question. But there are a lot more pictures in museums now, that's for sure.
But it does seem to be, in relation to, I think, Dale's question, a going away from the objectness in looking at a computer versus looking at scale or whatever in the museum.
But I think most of us saw pictures in books. We didn't see the original. So that was already a mediated experience. So I was not going to MoMA to look at photographs. I was looking at them on the printed page, which is already a different, and I think it informs all of our work in a slightly different way than if we were going to a museum and looking at actual prints. It's a kind of rarity to look at the actual thing. I actually prefer books.
Even when you were in New York, you didn't go take advantage of the print room at the Modern or the Met?
No. I like books. I don't want to speak for everyone, but yeah.
Okay, back here. But raise your hand a little higher.
Hi, what created the dead period of the 70s and what fueled the shift out of that in Los Angeles? The dead period with few exhibitions in Los Angeles through the 70s and early 80s, and what caused the shift out of that?
What created the vacuum or what?
You've been talking about how there were very few exhibitions, very few collections during the 70s and early 80s. So what caused that? And you talked about how when the MoCA opened, it changed that, and now there are a lot more exhibitions out. So what caused that shift?
Well, with the dead period up to, it's just there was the Pasadena Museum was kind of stuck in there for a while. Yeah, so we had, other than that, there wasn't much going on for, certainly photography prior to that.
But also MoCA was very different. I mean, because LACMA was collecting, sort of, but MoCA was very different. I mean, I think when you say MoCA changed things, you're talking about not only Dart, but you're talking about a much broader...
I'm not suggesting that there wasn't anything going on. I'm saying it's been a kind of forgotten period. A lot was going on, and it's not forgotten by art historians, but, this is a period that... hasn't received a lot of scrutiny, or for instance, when Cherry Martin did the photography and sculpture show, that was a real eye opener. Even though that was that 1970, and it was a show at MoMA, but it was a lot of West Coast artists in that show. Yeah. It was.
Ben Bunnell basically curated. He actually one of the things that he's talking about in the book that I was making reference to is that he discovered Richard Jackson, the painter, and that he visited him because Richard Jackson at that point was doing some work in a gallery and overheard Peter Bunnell asking about photographs functioning multidimensionally. And so Richard Jackson said, well, yeah, I have some things. Do you visit studios? So then he came to Richard Jackson's studio and saw these 8x10s that Jackson had made, the negatives. And then Peter asked him, do you have any prints of this? And Jackson looked at him and says, do I have to? And so there's that kind of shift that was operating on the West Coast that he then brought. And that's why there are so many West Coast individuals there and in that New York show.
It's really interesting, as somebody who saw the photography and the sculpture show, it fell dead in New York. It got terrible reviews. It was, if reviewed at all, I mean, it was astounding how little reception to it was. So
for me to read all the reviews that came out around Pacific Time and that show was, you know, it seemed that people were ready for it, you know? I mean, it's an interesting phenomena that the work got made, but there was no audience for it. Now, 40 years later, you know, there seems to be a recognition of where they might have been trying to go. But so many of those people, like Keith Smith, extraordinary artist who is the most unknown, you know, and just constantly producing, but there just hasn't been a place, and especially because John Sarkowski was so dominant, you know, and so his taste was so prevalent, and you know, the worst show John ever did was Mirrors and Windows. It was stupid. It was John put the windows in white frames and the mirrors in black frames. Get it? Black hats, white hats. You know, it just was just silly. And so Van Deren, when it came to San Francisco, he mixed them all up. I thought John was going to have a heart attack. But it was, but it spoke to John's just sheer influence, you know, in terms of what was and was not photography. John was the last great apotheosis of the modernist idea. That there was a thing that photography was, you know, and that it was to be, that the goal was to make it, you know, starts with Strand and Stieglitz and comes up, you know, and John was the last great apotheosis and incredibly articulate.
The photographer's eye was the Bible.
Well, you know, I mean, you know, it was hard to argue with John. Okay, another question. Why don't we take the gentleman in the white shirt? Oh, she's coming down. I'll just tell you all a funny story about John. I was talking to him before he got in.
Hi, my name is Dean.
I said something, and John said, "You interrupted me." And I said, "John, I'm sorry, I thought you were finished." He said, "It was a semicolon."
Gene Spiritus, two questions. First of all, you touched on a little bit about it. The role of the junior colleges, like Orange Coast College, in photography in the 70s, I think is really something that really has never really been explored in depth, and I think I'd like your interest about that. And secondly, why would one think anything differently than you think it took until 2014 to have a major retrospective of the person that we've been speaking about all morning, Robert Heineken, at MoMA? I mean, it seems to me that West Coast photography is of the 70s and of the 80s is finally getting its due, and it's never had its due in the United States, especially on the East Coast.
That's right.
And I think I'd like Ann to talk a little bit about that, because you're sitting here with, you know, some of the luminaries of Southern California photography who essentially were ignored on the West East Coast
until the present time. In fairness, I will tell you that curators of the modern have had a Heineken show on the table for years. And it couldn't get past Peter Thosey. And so that was just, you know, it just had to wait until Peter was not the director. But it was also because of the feminist period and the response to Bob's work as sexist. I mean, I have several regrets about the show at the MoMA. One of them is that she didn't put any of the male nudes in, because I thought it was an unfair representation. They weren't his best pieces, but he did them, and they needed that for balance. You know, yeah, it's like conceptual art skipping New York and going to Europe. Europe is where it had its audience.
Can I talk about Orange Coast or junior colleges, and I'll let you talk. One thing that happened with, first of all, Orange Coast College had John Upton, right, who was an extremely interesting and important figure in the history of photography, and was very open to embracing he hired a lot of really interesting people. Joanne and I both would go down there and print.
Why was he so important to photography? You've got to mention the book.
The Time Life series.
He wrote the textbook, but he also was a student of Minor White's, and yeah, I mean, he just an interesting guy. But the junior colleges had a budget that none of us had, because they decided to tell the state it was vocational. So that all the junior colleges had these great photography outfits, right? They had color processors before we did. They had everything, and some of them had like. I remember I went to apply for a job at Pierce Junior College, and the people running it all had buzz cuts and the pocket protectors, and I had a ponytail, and I went, well, okay, I'm not going to get this job. But in other places, like Orange Coast College, you had like these interesting people, and that really facilitated and made a lot of things possible. That's all I wanted to say about that.
Well, just to add on to it, that most of us from that, what Leland called the dead period, we're all taking extension courses there so that we could do our color printing here.
3 years. I slept down there this year, and then finally Cowart's got a process. But yeah, that was the place. There was nowhere else to do that. And he let us. So, yeah.
Okay. Yes, sir, down here. One down. And then I promise I'll come up.
Because you've had your arm up for a while. Right here, right down here. Thank you. What advice would you or have you given to any 11th grader, 12th grader who is determined to be a photographer?
You know, it's not photographer, it's artist, right? Yeah. It's the same advice. And the advice is that for me, after all these years, what differentiates the people that are successful or not successful, and I don't mean economically, I just mean in terms of being able to do the work, is how engaged they are in with the activity, like how immersive their interest is in the subject. So it's the same advice I'd give to somebody who said, should I be a philosopher or should I be a poet? Absolutely not, unless you have an incredibly deep desire and interest, unless it's something that your subconscious is working on when you're not thinking about it, unless it's an all-encompassing interest, pass on it. Do something else. We do not need giant university art programs or philosophy programs, right? We need fairly narrow programs to people that are really driven and intrinsically interested in those subjects.
As an example, I have a son that wanted to be a photographer and is a photographer. And I just thought, oh my God, it happened to me. So, but, I always was looking for, well, what do you do for a living? You know, like I'm thinking, maybe there's something I could do, but there's nothing else I would want to do except be an artist. I don't really know how to do anything else. And so it has to be that's why you do it, to satisfy that part of you, but.
Okay, the gentleman in the very back row has had his hand up for a while, and then that will have to be the last question. Right, got it right this time?
Hi, my name's Mark Stern. During the early 70s, I went to Cal State Northridge, and I took a class. I started a class with Jerry McMillan. I don't know if anyone else has ever had. He turned my whole life upside down on what photography was, and took it off the printed page, which I think the other person, Robert Sternberg, was another professor there who was teaching that area. But I was wanting to find out, I moved on and I have finished my MFA at UC Santa Barbara in 76, then tried and then toured with doing more, let's see, performance works. I was wondering, Is there more direction that are taking people off the page again and pulling into a more multimedia? I see it happening, but I listen to everyone, the staff on board right here, and I'm wanted to know what's the future. Where are we going now with this with this medium?
In 30 seconds or less.
First of all, it's a photo panel, so I mean, we're not probably going to talk too much about it before. But also Ed Sievers, who's the person I stayed with in Northridge, which was an ex-student of Callahan. And that's the thing about, since there was nowhere to sell work, you have this incredible pool of extraordinarily interesting people that needed to make a living. And so I think, so I ended up at Cal State Northridge, where you had Ed Sievers and McMillan and a guy named Brown. It was an extraordinary group of artists, at that Cal State University.
Ed Sievers was the one responsible for bringing a Callahan shell to that college, and an extraordinary encounter with actual prints by them, and a statement by Callahan. Anyway.
Okay, I want to thank all the panelists very much for a really great.
Thank you. Thank you to Anne, Joanne, John, Robert, and Jim. I just have a couple of announcements before we break for lunch. The symposium will continue at 2 p.m., so you have an hour and a half to grab a bite to eat. The Center for Photographs is open, so you also have an opportunity to see the current exhibitions, A Royal Passion, Queen Victorian Photography, and Hiroshi Sugimoto Past Tense. For anybody interested in publications by the panelists today, the bookstore in the main entrance hall does stock a few titles. So go take a look. You might be able to convince some of these people to sign them at the end of the day. So we'll see you back here at 1:50 p.m. Again, please turn in your tickets if you're departing for the day.